I'm here to present the Gra.fo experience, which is a three-year project jointly conducted by Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa and University of Siena, and partially financed by Tuscan Region. I also have been asked by Italian Association of Oral History to represent it officially in this workshop, so I'm very happy to be here and I'm learning a lot about metadata, especially. So, this is a short outline of the talk, and here you can find some quantitative data on the project. We digitized 2,800 hours containing the voices of 950 interviewees and 143 interviewers. 11 people were involved as staff, and now since the project is officially ended, only one person is still working on metadata description. Why this project? So, Gra.fo was born with the aim of discovering oral archives in Tuscany, preserving audio materials that would otherwise face deterioration, cataloging audio material, and making these materials, often forgotten by the same researchers who had collected them, available to a wider public by means of an online portal. Here you can find the main building blocks of the project. Let's start with census. We made a survey of Tuscan oral archives containing oral history, anthropology, linguistics, ethnography, folklore studies, and so on, trying to answer to the following questions. Where are the sound archives of Tuscany stored? How are they preserved? Who are their owners? And what kind of accessibility do they have? So we prepare a priority list according to the relevance and antiquity of the materials, geographic representativeness, and the state of preservation of the materials. We contacted the sound archives owners, and we signed legal agreements with the owners. In the case of oral archives, we do not have a proper bibliography or accompanying materials, so we use also the "tell something about your archive" interview in order to understand the motivation and aims of the research. And this interview is, in our opinion, very important, as in many cases it allows to get the key for interpreting and cataloging the archives, which are often clearly understandable only by the same researchers who collected them. At least in some fields, it is like that. In some cases, we collected also, if any, the accompanying materials, that is to say, any relevant notes, drawing, diaries produced during the research, before or after, or during the field work itself. Here you can find a sheet containing information of a field work carried out in Montale near Pistoia in 1973 from the Carta dei Dialetti Italiani, the chart of Italian dialects archive, which is one of the most relevant diachronic data on Italian vernacular speech. We devote great attention to this kind of materials, and we digitize them and making them available for the user together with the sound recordings and the cataloging records. Now let's move to step two, that is preservation. Once the audio material gets into the laboratory, you can see here, you can see a photo of a laboratory of linguistics in Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa. The original carrier is prepared for playback, and at this point restoration procedures are carried out if necessary. And then the playback takes place and the signal is transferred and archived on new carriers. And during this process, control procedures are constantly carried out, but I'm not the right person to explain it since I'm not a science on computer and sound and music computing, so I skip this part. Now let's move to a step which is closer to my interest. To my work, that is analysis. we described oral documents by means of an open source software system, and we gave information about the archive, a short description, the owner, the location, the existence of the tell something about your archive interview, policy limits, and date of adherence to the project, and so on. And in addition, we gave information on the single oral document, that is, we prepare an abstract, the topology, topics, genre of the document, and language variety. We gave information about the interview and the interviewer, and any related documents, scientific papers, books, accompanying materials, if any. Here you can see it is only in Italian, the record material. So, for instance, topic, we prepare 130 different topics, such as biographies, cinema, immigration, environment, fascism, and so on. And we defined 40 different genres, such as interview, answer to linguistic questionnaire, lullaby, poem, proverb, and so on. And as for language varieties, we had 30 different varieties according to the most influent linguistic taxonomy in Tuscan. In some cases, we provide also orthographic transcription, trying to offer a balance between fidelity to speech and comprehensibility and consistency among different varieties and different vernacular speech of Tuscany. And in some cases, also some IPA transcriptions according to the international phonetic alphabets. But I have to say that the transcription are not linked to the waveform yet. It is a desideratum for the future. The working flow can be summarized in this diagram. The audio from the preservation copy together with the metadata and the transcription, if any, and the accompanying materials, if any, constitute the documental or fruition unit, we can say. In an ideal world, the preservation copy should correspond to the audio document that the final user can listen to. That is to say, something like that. One analog cassette that corresponds to the audio document to the preservation copies. So this would happen in an ideal world. In field work, it is not always this case, since due to cost reasons, to the importance of the document's transcription more than the carrier and more than the recording session, it happens that researchers use it, at least in the past, not nowadays, use it to fully exploit the carriers and using any portion of them, and also recording on the same carriers. So a document, for instance, an interview or a biography, can be distributed over various carriers or, crucially, portions of carriers, so that one and the same carrier may contain various unrelated documents, while more than one carrier can refer to one and the same document. So therefore, at least in dialectology and field work in 70s, 60s at least, of the past century, the documental unit must be viewed as independent from the carriers, to be seen as a mere container. And we had to face this textual problem, let's say, in creating these digital archives. So in order to preserve the authenticity and reliability of the new digital objects, some key issues need to be taken into account. First of all, and this is somehow obvious, the audio documents preserved in oral archives should be considered as text, deserving the same philological attention as written text. But, and this is crucial, audio documents may be contextless. which means that a great deal of effort must be devoted to reconstructing the scenario in which they were recorded. In some cases, we had the transcription without the recordings, or the recordings without the transcription, or field work associated with some parts of the analog carriers, and so on. So this was a very difficult task for us to find out a way. And we tried to speculate on it. So I'm here also to ask if we are on the right way or not. In the digital domain, different analog objects, for instance, side A and B of a compact cassette or different open reel tapes can be joined together, provided they refer to the same communicative event. But in some cases, we are not able to identify the communicative event. We are not sure that we are not sure whether this what we are listening to is a unique documental event, a unique communicative event. So the identification of the documental unit is very, very problematic, at least for us. And in this experience, we found that the editing of digital audio documents in domain other than art music is a relative new enterprise with no strong background of knowledge and experience. We refer to one of the most qualified guides concerning the edition of oral archives, so that is the guide of Phonothèque of Aix-en-Provence, a guide d'analyse documentaire du son inédit pour la mise en place des banques de données. And we find such definition. Quant à la définition de l'unité documentaire traitée, c'est au collecteur de l'établir dans les cas d'une enquête ou d'un collectage, l'unité est un fait culturel. But we are not sure that we are able to find that, first of all, the researcher may be no longer available. And this is one problem. Secondly, the fieldwork itself may be problematic with respect to the reconstruction of the time and the recording sessions. In some cases, not only are time, place, and communicative context unknown, especially in the geolinguistic enterprise, but also we do not ever know whether the portion preceding and following the interruption belong to the same or to different events. So in such cases, the editing process becomes somehow arbitrary. Third, the accompanying documents may be scattered among different institutions or even lost. So in order to make the content of oral archives accessible to a wider public, the oral archive had to be inventoried and catalogued. But this kind of split, decomposition and recomposition, can only be done after an appropriate reconstruction of the history, the context, and the research project that has been at the base of a single archive. So only by means of a comparative inspection of different archives, it is possible to propose a richer definition of the documental unit, at least, accounting for genre, goals, research protocols, and communicative context, if known, of the recording. In some cases, we are not able to reconstruct all the context, all the communicative context of the recording. So we try to find a sort of provisional taxonomy, and we defined each documental unit according to the following categorization. We had specific genres, for instance, oral biography, folk songs, proverbs, and in this case, the documental unit is the single object elicited by the researcher. That is to say, the single life story, or the single song, or the single proverb. In the case of the interview with a questionnaire, the unit consists of all of the answers given by the same person to the questionnaire in a unitary communicative context, that is to say in the same context and not two or three or 1 week after. In the case of observed event, for instance, meeting or veglia, that is to say the narration of stories which is typical in the countryside of Tuscany, the documental unit is the recording of the complete event observed. And finally, other situational recording where the researcher is a mere witness and has no influence on what happens, for instance, public performances or documents collected with hidden recording modality. So the documental unit in this case is the single events recording. Now let's move to the last step, that is sharing. We finally built a web portal. Here you can see the screenshot of the homepage. Here is the number of hours we digitized. The description is in Italian, but we provide a short English description for the main aspects of the project. We allowed two different browsing procedures. It is possible to do to make a geographic search. If you click on the map of Tuscany, you will see all the archives related on a certain particular area, and you can click on the single archive and see how many units are contained inside the single archive. Or you can make a search by content according to language variety, topics, genre, argument, and so on. This is a browsing example. Here, this is a documental unit of a sound archives archive collecting in the domain of oral history on popular religiosity in the Maremma, in south of Tuscany. These are interviews with parish priests collected in the 80s. You can see the abstract of the document, the description of the archives, the timeline, all the metadata, and here you can download an MP3 audio for the listening. Now the last maybe thorny issue is the legal aspects of this project. We try to inform all the people and with whom we signed legal agreements for the borrowing of the materials, but we had to find also all the people involved in the registry, in the recording. So, according to the Italian law, with regard to all the processing of oral sources, all the interviewee must provide their express consent. The problem is that most of the documents contained in Grafo were collected before the application of the Code of Personal Data Protection. They were 60s and 70s and 80s documents. So in this case, we envisaged a three-level solution, let's say. We had a full online access in case of no personal data, for instance, songs and lullabies and proverbs. We define a partial online access with some information deleted. So in the MP3 format, we cut all the personal data. You can have the original waveform in the preservation copy, which is not accessible by the web. And we had also cases of no access when personal data and privacy restriction were too hard for us to the internet diffusion. In case of no access via web, oral documents can be physically accessed in the laboratory according to the code of conduct and professional practice regarding the processing of oral data for historical purposes. So the researcher can come to Pisa or Siena and see and have access to the data. Just two starting points for the conclusion. The future of Grafo, first of all, we have to We start from a region. Tuscany is a rich region from the point of view of oral archives. So the work is not finished, but we should go beyond Tuscany, for instance, try to make available Carta dei dialetti italiani, which is the most important diachronic data of linguistic service from 60s to 80s in Italy, which is not available at all to the scientific community. We should also try to link these archives with textual linguistic resources, for instance AltoWeb, which is hosted at Istituto di Linguistica Computazionale in Pisa, and that's why we started a collaboration with Monica and Francesca. And secondly, as a linguist, I try to put together Italian linguists and oral historians in a national project which is currently under evaluation and which is called the Viva Voce project, with University of Siena, University of Trento, University of Venice and Scuola Normale Superiore, together with Italian Association of Oral History, in order to work on these keywords: preservation, dissemination, reuse of research data related to oral archives. So that's why I'm here, and I really feel to be in the right place at the right time. So thank you for your kind attention.